Alright, good evening, church. Hopefully you are having an amazing day. You know what? We're recording this early. It's still a little overcast, but it's supposed to be 60s today. Almost 70, isn't it?
67, yeah. That's what they say anyways.
So hopefully you've enjoyed a beautiful sunny day, and thank you for being with us. We got Pastor Brian here tonight, and so we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 1. 2 Samuel chapter 1. So, alright.
That's awesome.
You like that?
You said good morning, and then you said we got Pastor Brian with us tonight.
It is going to be night. You know what? All right. Yeah. Hey, this is live recording.
Okay, yes.
So here we are. We got two cameras set up in case one doesn't sound good. So if we're going to look back and forth. I don't know which one's going to work. So.
Okay.
Why don't you get us started here? 2 Samuel chapter 1.
Now it came to pass after death of Saul, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David had abode 2 days in Ziklag, he came even to pass on the third day, and that behold, a man came out of the camp of Saul with his clothes rent and the earth upon his head. And so it was, when he came to David, that he fell to the earth and did obedience. And David said unto him, From whence comest thou? And he said unto him, Out of the camp of Israel am I escaped. And David said unto him, How went the matter? I pray thee, tell me. And he answered, that the people are fled from the battle, and many of the people also are fallen and dead. And Saul and Jonathan, his son, are dead also. And David said unto the young man that told him, How knowest thou that Saul and Jonathan, his son, be dead? And the young man that told him said, I happened by chance upon the mount of Gilboa, and behold, Saul leaned upon his spear, and lo, the chariots and the horsemen followed hard after him. And when he looked behind him, he saw me and called unto me. And I answered, Here am I. And he said unto me, Who art thou? And I answered him, I am the Amalekite. And he said unto me again, Stand, I pray thee, upon me and slay me, for anguish has come upon me because my life is yet whole in me. So I stood upon him and slew him, because I was sure that he could not live after that he was fallen. And I took the crown that was upon his head and the bracelet that was on his arm, and have brought them hither unto my lord.
All right. Now, if we remember, King Saul, they're in this battle. He gets wounded, I think, by a stray arrow or something, right? Mm-hmm. And he turns to his armor bearer and says, I need you to kill me so the other guys don't come and do worse. We just read about this a few days ago. And the guy says, no, I can't do that. And so Saul falls on his own spear. Mm-hmm. And then the armor bearer, he takes his own life too, right? And so now we see Saul he's kind of still suffering in this state. Right. And this Amalekite thinks he's doing something good, right? I'm putting him out of his misery. He asked me to do this. He's mm-hmm. suffering. He's not going to get better. This is what should be done. And I did a good thing. So, you know, you see someone suffering, you see an animal maybe suffering inside the road, they got hit, you're like, oh yeah, we got to put it out of its misery. We don't want to see them suffer. And here's how he comes and presents it. You know, everybody died, but I made it here to show you.
Right.
And, yeah. And then he says here in verse 11, then David took hold of his clothes and tore them. So also did all the men who were with him. They mourned and wept and fasted until evening for Saul and his son Jonathan, and for the people of the Lord and the house of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword. David said to the young man who told him, Where are you from? And he answered, I am the son of an alien, an Amalekite. So he was a foreigner. Mm-hmm. Then David said to him, How is it that you were not afraid to stretch out your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? You know, I think of that phrase right there. How is it you were not afraid to stretch out your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? Now, we can all have our thoughts on, you know, was Saul the one that was supposed to be there? We know Saul wasn't a great, he had some great moments, mm-hmm. but he also had some not so great moments. Mm-hmm. But he was the one that was put in authority and in that place. And it wasn't this guy, especially a foreigner's job, to take his life now.
Well, and I also, you know, look at, like, just the reverence that even David had for, like, Saul.
Yes.
And, you know, the Lord, you know, Lord, what does the Lord say? You know, love the Lord your God and love thy enemy or love thy neighbor. You know, love. And towards the end there, Saul was kind of an enemy of David. I mean, that was like his personal enemy, you know.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, but David still showed respect there, reverence that, you know, it was an anointing from the Lord. And I think that David, even though he was, you know, hunted by Saul and, you know, like hated by Saul, David still, I think, had a love and a respect for Saul.
This was such a great example of reverence, even for when you have every reason to do the opposite.
Right.
You know, we watched as David came and he snuck into the camp. Like there was one where they were in the back of the cave and Saul comes in to relieve himself, right? And mm-hmm. and he goes and he could have taken his life there, but he didn't. And then he comes down and they were all sleeping and David and his buddy, they snuck into camp and they took the water jug and, mm-hmm. and they had a chance to kill him there and they didn't. And multiple times, you know, David always took the high road, but I think he respected the position of authority, mm-hmm. that this was someone God had placed as the leader, the head, whether he was godly or ungodly. We read that the Spirit of God left Saul. Mm-hmm. And I think about even in today's society that, you know, with some of the leaders that we have in place, with some of the stuff that's going on, we would say, oh, man, if we had... No. The thing is, we are supposed to respect the position,
right.
Maybe not the person all the time. And David just does a great example.
Well, and I think it really kind of shows the difference between the two hearts, too.
Yeah.
I mean, Saul, you know, he wanted to destroy David. I don't think that David ever really wanted to destroy Saul. That wasn't his heart.
No.
There was a completely different, it shows the two different hearts, you know, where their hearts were. Saul wanted to destroy David because of the jealousy, and David, he had a different heart. But David had his own problems, obviously. We all do. We all have suffered from different problems. But David's heart wasn't to destroy Saul. That was never his intention. And so I think it really shows a good view of, you know, where people's hearts are on the matter. And I just love the fact that, like you said, David had multiple times where he could have killed Saul, but I don't think David really wanted Saul dead because that wasn't where his heart was.
Right.
You know, he wanted to serve the Lord and just do what the Lord asked him. But also another thing that we can look at is when it says, you know, the Spirit of the Lord left Saul is, you know, as far as like even leaders, you know, us that have, you know, God has put into authority to lead or to pastor or, you know, we need to be very, very careful because, you know, God, if you're not doing what, you know, and being obedience and you're not doing what God's asked you to do, I really believe that God will come and take your mantle away. So, I mean, it's something that, you know, I think it's more of kind of a warning for pastors when I look at the story of Saul. You know, he lost his mantle because he did not obey and he did not do it the way God wanted it to do. And he was actually the one that was in authority. It wasn't the people. It was the people looking to him. So, you know, hey.
Yeah.
Something we need to watch and always seek the Lord's will and not our own and be in obedience.
When I think of, you know, David, because he would come in when there was the evil spirit that was tormenting Saul. David would come in and sing and play his lyre, his guitar, or whatever, and said the Spirit would leave him. So David got a chance to see this transformation. He saw the good Saul and the tormented Saul, and almost the potential in him. And that's why he never gave up on him as well, is because he also knew the way he was put in, but he also saw the change that happened in Saul. And I think all of us know people. I want you to see what happens at the end of this story. Because David said to the young men, "Where are you from?" Verse 13, "I am the son of an alien, an Amalekite." Verse 14, then David said to him, "How is it that you are not afraid to stretch out your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed?" And David called one of the young men and said, "Go cut him down." What does your translation say over there?
In 15?
Yeah.
It says, David called one of his young men and said, "Go near and fall upon him." And he smote him that died.
Yeah, so they go and said, "You know what, you think you did a good thing, putting him out of his misery or obeying his command? Let me tell you, that was that." And then coming here to tell me that this is a good thing, this is not a good thing. And yet, David just executed him right there. He says, David said to him, "Your blood is on your head, for your mouth has testified against you, saying, I have killed the Lord's anointing." And it's just, it's a fascinating story that here this young man comes thinking that he he's doing something good. He's thinking, I'm bringing good news of the battle. I mean, the battle was bad, but you know what? I'm an outsider, and I'm just going to share what happened and how I know. And David said, you are wrong in what you did. And I think that's what gets us in trouble, is sometimes doing what we think is right on our own, but really overstepping the boundaries that we have. Any last thoughts on this passage?
Well, I would say, you know, I mean, one of the things that kind of stuck out to me is he said that all died, right? but yet he miraculously got out of there, you know, this one. Everybody, you know, well, I mean, it did say that there's some other fleed, but, you know, I think this guy's heart wasn't right either. It's almost like he probably felt like he needed, you know, it was almost like going to be rewarded, right? You know?
Right. And, yeah, I think there was a movie about that. Which one? I don't remember. Anyways, we fought to the last soldier.
Right.
It was obviously not, and it was one guy who comes.
Right.
It's so. All right. Well, hey, that's about our time there. We, you know, we appreciate you spending some time with us. I love the story of David, the heart that he had, but we also learn a lot from King Saul and the struggles that he dealt with constantly, and. You know what? Many of us can relate to people like that as well. So thank you for spending some time. Let us pray with you.
God bless.
Julie, you want to pray?
Yeah. Praise God. Father, I just want to thank you for your grace and your mercy. I want to thank you for your word, Lord. I want to thank you for revealing your word, things that we can learn, Lord, that we can live by, Lord. And I just thank you for giving us this, you know, this special book that we can get into and learn and grow our relationship with you. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing in this community. Lord, I just ask a special blessing over Pastor Jose this week, Lord. Be with him. Be with everybody in this church, Lord. Bring somebody new in that we can share your amazing gospel and love with. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God bless. Have a great evening. We'll see you on Sunday.